So I hope our praise and worship session got you guys a little bit warmed up and ready. We have a great message today for all of you again. Once again, I saw a few more of our youths come in, so welcome each and every one of you to this combined youth session. So actually, Horeb Church is completing 7 years as a parish. So we had our one-day retreat today, and as a part of that, we thought, you know, it'd be great to get all of our youth fellowship members from the Los Angeles area together for a, you know, night of praise and worship, of fellowship, of being in the Word, you know. So we've been praying for this, and we really pray that you guys also can give your whole focus and take part in this, and it'll be a great blessing for each and every one of you. So we have a great speaker here to speak to us from the Word. Let me introduce him. His name is Sam John. So he comes all the way from Dallas, Texas. He's just like each of us, raised here in the U.S., in the North Omaha Church, and now he's a great servant leader for our church. And growing up, he was a great inspiration and for all of our youth. So I know that his message is going to be one that you guys will give your full attention to, and it will be a blessing on your life. So without further delay, that's all I'm going to say. I'm going to turn it over to Sam John. So everybody just give him a nice welcome as he comes up here.
Some steps, and we'll kind of talk through some things and have some sort of a program or a step-by-step strategy on how to get through their struggles, right? And I tell them, hey, make sure you go do this week, right? And then they'll go out and they'll go do that thing that I hope they would do, and they come back the following week to the session, and then I check in with them. I say, hey, how was this last week? How did that homework assignment go? And this is what I hear from client number two. Client number two is like, oh, yeah, you know what? Yeah, about that assignment, I never got around to it. I never got around to it because work was really super, super busy, and this was happening, and this was happening, and this was happening. I said, okay, it's fine. You know, life happens. So for this week, I'd like for you to go out there and do this as well. And he's like, yeah, I'm on it, Sam. Here, I'm gonna write it down right now, right? And then they go out at the session, the week later, they come back, and I say, hey, how'd that homework assignment go? Yeah, about that. So here's the thing, my wife got really busy with this, and so I had to take care of the kids, and little Junior, he came out with the flu, so I had to take care of him, and I really didn't get a chance to do the homework. And week after week, they come back into the session, and I ask them to do something, and they really don't. That's client number two. Client number three that comes into my office is very similar to client number two, who knows that they have a struggle, who knows that there is issues. They know that they need help. They know that they need assistance. And then when I give them a homework assignment, and they go out there and they actually do it, and then they come back into the session, and I ask them to check in with them and say, hey, how was this week? And they sit there and go, Sam, it was hard. Like, I didn't want to do it some days, but I did it because you told me to do it, and I went ahead and did it. And God, it was good. Okay, so here's what I want you to do. I want you to try doing this this week. And they go out there and do that. And they come back in, and I tell them, hey, how'd that week go? And they sit there and they say, it was good. Like, this actually helped, Sam. Like, when you said this and you said that, that really, I could relate to that. And I was able to practice these things, and it really worked. I'm starting to feel hope in it. Like, these thoughts that are going through my head, it's starting to kind of go away. I'm starting to understand that there is hope for me. And they come back in week after week, and they get better and better and better. Some of you that are seated here today are client number one. You're here because everybody else is here. You're forced to be here. You really don't want to be here. You're here, sure, I'll just check it off the box. And I'm sad, and I'm frustrated, because there are a lot of people, a lot of youth that resemble client number one. There's some of you here that are client number two. You know there's something more to life. You know that there's got to be something greater than what you're already doing. You know that there is something inside of you that says there is someone greater than who I am. You know you've heard these sermons, and there's something inside of you that keeps calling you back to hearing more and more messages. But my frustration and my sadness for client number two is that you won't do anything with it. You're that person that comes to the conferences. You're that person that comes to the Bible studies because you just need to be there. Some of you got just pushed into a van and just driven over here, and you're here because you're here. Some of you, and this is even what Scripture says, there's a few of you that are client number three. But you really do understand that there is a living God. That there, the Bible, what it says, there's a whole lot of truth to it. You are yearning. You want more. And you're ready to drink it up. Because deep down inside of you, your soul is thirsty. And you are starting to understand there's only one thing that can quench that thirst. My hope and my prayer is that you leave here however you came, as client number one, or client number two, or client number three, that I hope and pray that all of you will leave here like client number three, taking what we learned here today and doing something with it. That this would not be just a really cool sermon with some really cool illustrations, but that this would be something that would really penetrate your heart and that you would do something with it. That's my hope and my prayer for all of you that are here. So before we get started, let's just start with a quick word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father God, for this opportunity. I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity for me to be able to stand here in front of your children, your youth, the leaders of tomorrow of this church, of the body of the church. I pray, Lord, that you would be here in this midst. I pray that the Spirit would move in and out of each and every individual that is here, and that they would be moved and transformed and convicted by the words that are spoken. I pray that the words from your Holy Scripture would be penetrating to the hearts and minds of those that are seated here. And if there is anything that I say that is not of you, I pray that those words would just evaporate and they would only be hearing the words that you would want them to hear. So we ask all these things in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. So I'm going to need an assistance from two people. Can I get two volunteers? Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah, okay, one. Okay, two. Steve, and what's your name? Joanna. Okay, come on up. It's not anything big. All I'm just going to ask you to do is to read. Worst day ever. Has anybody heard this poem before? Awesome. Cool. Okay, so here's what I want you to do. Steve, I want you to read first. Top down. Just read. Line by line.
Today was the absolute worst day ever. And don't try to convince me that there's something good in every day. Because when you take a closer look, this world is a pretty evil place. Even if some goodness does shine through once in a while, satisfaction and happiness don't last. And it's not true that it's all in the mind and the heart. Because true happiness can be attained only if one's surroundings are good. It's not true that good exists. I'm sure you can agree that the reality creates my attitude. It's all beyond my control. And you'll never in a million years hear me say that today was a very good day.
Thank you. You can hand it over to Joanna. Joanna, hold on a second. Go back. No, last, the third slide. Yep, right there. What's the, what, Stephen, what he just read, Steve, what's the takeaway there? What'd you hear? What's the perspective? Yeah. I'm sorry? Yeah. It's a negative perspective. What's so negative about it? I'm sorry? Yes. Exactly. Anybody else? Yeah. Yes, yes, and no matter what you do, you will never, ever, ever convince me that today was a good day, right? Now here's what we're going to do. We're going to take the exact same poem, and Joanna, here's what I want you to do. I want you to start on the last line and read up one line at a time. Does that make sense? Go for it.
Today was a very good day, and you'll never in a million years hear me say that it's all beyond my control. My attitude creates the reality. I'm sure that you can agree that it's not true that good exists only if one's surroundings are good. True happiness can be attained because it's all in the mind and heart. And it's not true that satisfaction and happiness don't last. Some goodness does shine through once in a while, even if the world is a pretty evil place. Because when you take a closer look, there's something good in every day. And don't try to convince me that today was the absolute worst day ever.
Great, thank you. You guys can take a seat. What's that perspective? Positive, yeah. What else? me kind of give you the answers. Okay, the second perspective is positive, just like what he said. What's your name? Arun? Yeah, just, oh, we got a Hutchins name, that's cool. So, what Arun said is, the second time around, when Joanna read it, she read it from the bottom going back up to the very top. Same words. There was nothing changed. The only thing that was changed was the direction of how the poem was read, right? It's the way you look at things. It's your perspective on life. And today's theme is facing the giants. Facing your giants is going to heavily depend upon how you see things, your perspective of the giants that you face, okay? So we're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. Keep in mind what we just talked about. This is all about perspective of how you see things. Okay? Now, 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17 is going to be about the story of David and Goliath. We've all heard about the story of David and Goliath, right? It's a story that we all grew up in, hearing since the time we were little kids in Sunday school all the way to where we are today. Right? So I'm going to hopefully show you some things in this story that maybe you just didn't understand. Okay? So we're going to start in verse 1. 1 Samuel 17, verse 1. And I'm going to read from, if you're on your phone, if you want to follow along with what I'm reading from the NLT. Okay? New Living Translation. Okay, so if you just, it's up to you. But pick a passage that, or a translation that you really enjoy. And if you want to, you can just listen to me too. Okay, it's up to you. So verse 1. The Philistines now mustered their army for battle and camped between Soka and in Judah and Azekah at the infamous Ephes Damon. Saul countered by gathering his Israelite troops near the valley of Elah. So the Philistines and the Israelites faced each other on opposite hills with the valley between them, okay? So here we have the Philistine army, okay? We just kind of tell you what the Philistine army. They are Israel's worst enemy. The worst enemy. The Philistines have gone from country to country to country, overpowering and taking them. They have taken people into slavery. They have beaten, they have killed people because they feel like they are greater than every other nation out there. So they have been on this rampage of trying to take and conquer other nations. Israel just happens to be the next country. So here's Israel on one side of the hill, and then here's the Philistine army on another side of the hill, and they're facing each other. Now think about this. Here you are facing your worst enemy. Now here's what I want you to do. When we talk about Goliath, I don't want you to think of Goliath. What I want you to do is replace Goliath with your worst fear. What are you afraid of? Think of what it is that you are afraid of, and I want you to think about that every time you hear Goliath. Okay? So here's how it's going to go. You are on opposite hills, and you are facing your giant. And this giant is going to taunt you, as we're going to see. And this is what happens. Verse 4, then Goliath, a Philistine giant champion from Gath, came out of the Philistine ranks to face the forces of Israel. He was over 9 feet tall. He wore a bronze helmet, and his bronze coat of mail weighed 125 pounds. He also wore bronze leg armor, and he carried a bronze javelin on his shoulder. The shaft of his spear was as heavy and thick as a weaver's beam, tipped with an iron spearhead that weighed 15 pounds. His armor bearer walked ahead of him carrying a shield. So, when I was preparing this message, I had in my mind, I was sort of thinking, what does this look like, right? This Goliath guy. It says here that he's over 9 feet tall. And if you go looking into the Greek, It's about 9 feet, he's 9 feet, 9 inches tall. Now here's the thing, in 1940, there was a gentleman that was born that was 8 feet, 11 inches. That's the tallest person that's been recorded in our recent history. 8 feet, 11 inches, taller than any of the NBA players. Goliath is 9 feet, 9 inches. So in my mind, I'm sitting there thinking, how tall is that? How tall is 9 feet, 9 inches? So here's what I wanted to do. If somebody could help me, if I can get an assistant, to help me really understand what this means, how tall he is, if I can get somebody to come up and hold this for me, all you're doing is just hold it. Just anybody. Anybody. You're killing me, people. Yeah, no, just hold it right here for me. Just like this. No, up here. Yeah, just hold it. Here. Can you hold a little bit higher? Yeah, there you go. Just like that. This is Goliath. That's 9 feet, 9 inches. I'm 5'10", hopefully, somewhere right there. Right? I'm 5'10". This is 9 feet, 9 inches. This is who Goliath, who Israel is facing. This is the man that is on the other side of that hill who is taunting Israel. This guy, now here's the thing, as we just got through reading, he's not just by all just his t-shirt and jeans. He's wearing heavy armor. So I don't want you to think of Goliath as a skinny guy who just happens to be tall like an NBA player. I need you to really think of Goliath like Shaquille O'Neal. Big, huge, and tall. Right? He's a big guy. He's got big muscles. He's a thick guy because his armor is 125 pounds. That means it cannot be some skinny guy who just happened to be wearing 125 pounds. This is a guy who's built. Does that make sense? In order to take that on that kind of armor, this is a guy who is 9 feet tall and he is stout. Right? Thank you, I appreciate it. So, a guy that tall, wearing that kind of armor, is very, very intimidating. He is not somebody who you can look at and go, I can take him. This is a very, very intimidating individual. And now this is what we see that takes place. Goliath stood and shouted a taunt across to Israelites. Why are you coming out to fight, he called. I am the Philistine champion, but you are only the servants of Saul. Choose one man to come stand before me and fight me. If he kills me, then we will be your slaves. But if I kill him, you will be our slaves. I defy the armies of Israel today. Send me a man who will fight me. When Saul and the Israelites heard this, they were terrified and deeply shaken. Terrified and deeply shaken. What does that mean? Terrified is fear. Deeply shaken, a whole lot of anxiety. Fear and anxiety takes over the people of Israel. Because you've got this 9 feet, 9 inch tall, huge mammoth of a man standing there beating his chest and talking and taunting the Israel camp, saying, who do you think you are? Do you really think that you can defeat us? Here's what I'm willing to do. I challenge you to bring a man, stand here before me, and fight me. Forget all of these armies. You don't have to bring your armies. We'll just do this mano-a-mano, one-on-one. I dare you to bring somebody. And he's taunting them. He's basically standing there in front of them, calling them a chicken. Right? And what does Israel do? They're shaking in their boots. They're anxious and they're afraid. Why? Because they hear what Goliath the same. Now remember what I told you to do? Whenever you hear Goliath, I want you to replace it with your ears. This is what happens. As a counselor, as a therapist, what I see with people who deal with anxiety, with people who struggle with depression, who struggle with heightened sense of fear, is that they are listening to a certain voice. And that voice, they are hearing over and over and over. And this is what's happening here. Goliath comes, stands before the Israel army, and he is shouting at the top of his lungs, I dare you to come. I dare for you to find somebody that can stand against me. There's no way you're going to be able to do this. I will defeat anyone that you bring, and whoever it is that you bring, if I kill them, you become my what? Slave. And that's what happens in the brain. Anxiety and depression is all about being a slave to what you think and what you start to believe. Does that make sense? Whatever it is that you think, whatever it is that you believe, you will be enslaved to it. These guys, grown men, listened to the words of their biggest fear, and they started to shake in fear and anxiety. This is what we see. Verse 16. For 40 days, every morning, every evening, the Philistine champion Goliath strutted in front of the Israelite army. For 40 long days. Every day, Goliath came out in front of the Israel camp, in front of the Israel people, and started to beat his chest and say the same thing over and over. There is something that you are listening to, you are starting to believe, over and over and over about yourself. I've spoken at many churches across the U.S. with a lot of the youth, and I have a lot of people that come up to me, youth members, that will come up to me after my talks, and they will tell me that they are struggling with a lot of stuff in their own personal life. Depression, anxiety, heightened sense of fear, shame, guilt, whatever it may be. I've had young girls come to me and just cry because they're struggling with certain things that are going on in their mind. I've had a guy that came up to me at one of the conferences and said that he was struggling with depression and that he was afraid to tell anybody that he was struggling with depression. Because if he told somebody that he was struggling with that he would feel shame for it. That he would not be like everybody else. Because men, guys, we don't struggle with depression. That's for weak people. So there's this belief that we tend to believe because we hear this messaging over and over and over. And I will tell you this, the people you surround yourself with is extremely important. Because the people you surround yourself with will send you a message about you. That messaging is going to be that you are either important or that you are not good enough. That you are valuable or that you are not very valuable. You're devalued by the things that they say. And I can't, like I get really hurt and I get really worked up when I see people having friends that are just speaking negativity. They won't change their friendships because they feel like, who else am I going to have as friends? If I get rid of this person, then who am I going to have a friendship with? So they maintain that relationship, and all that relationship does is continue to make them feel this small. Who are you surrounding yourself with? Because the people you surround yourself with will fill you up or they will deplete you. And this is what Goliath was doing. For 40 long days, he was going out there, sending out a message to the people of Israel and depleted their sense of hope and courage and strength to the point they continued to be afraid and anxious. until somebody steps into the picture. Let's continue to read. Verse 23. As he was talking to them, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, came out of the Philistine ranks. Then David heard him shout his usual taunt to the army of Israel. The usual taunt, right? So David comes to the camp because his father tells him, hey, take some bread and some food to your brothers because your brothers are in this army and they're facing the Philistines. And David, can you take some bread? Now here's the thing with David. David is just, what? What is David at this point? What's that? Yeah, he's a shepherd boy, right? He's got other brothers, and his brothers are in the army, right? And David wants to be out there. But his father is just like, no, you're too young, you're too little, you're just a shepherd boy. That's for your brothers. They need to be in the army, but you need to stay behind. So he's like, okay, right? And so then what is his father do? His father tells him, hey, look, since you're the youngest and your brothers are out there, here's a basket of food. Take this basket of food and take it to the army and give it to your brothers. And David's like, okay. So as David goes to the campsite to where the Israel camp is, he hears from a distance this giant. He hears from a distance what Goliath is saying. He hears the usual taunting. And this is what happens. Verse 24, as soon as the Israelite army saw him, they began to run away in fright. Have you seen the giant? He comes out each and every day to defy Israel, and the king has offered a huge reward to anyone who kills him. Verse 26, David asked the soldiers standing nearby, what will a man get for killing this Philistine and ending his defiance of Israel? Who is this pagan Philistine anyway, that he is allowed to defy the armies of the living God? Verse 32. Don't worry about this Philistine, David said. I will go fight him. Right? Who says that? Think about this. Here you are, you're in this army, you've got the gear on, you've got armor on, and here comes this little pipsqueak little boy. He's a shepherd boy, and he comes in and he goes, hey guys, what's that all about? Like, who is this guy? Who is this guy that's defying all of us? Like, I'll go fight him, right? Why would a little shepherd boy come and see the giant, the same giant the entire army is seeing, but see it from a different perspective? Why? It's similar because of this. David understands that what he has experienced and who God is, that he is a living God. And because he has experienced a relationship with God, he knows that he is under the protection of God. That this living God has seen him through his hardest times and he has never failed him. So what does David understand? David understands he's under the umbrella of God's protection. As long as I'm under God's sovereignty, as long as I am under his word, as long as I believe in who he is, I'm under his protection. And then he looks at David, at Goliath and the Philistine army, and he goes, guys, do you not see this? They're not under the protection of our living God. They're not. We are. Why are you afraid? And he says, I'll go. Send me. I'll fight him. Like, who is it? Who is this guy that can say something like that? It's a guy that knows who he is. He knows who he is because of who he believes in. His faith in this living God gives him an identity of who he is, what he can do, and what he can get through. Does that make sense? It's extremely important that you understand that. He's under the protection and sovereignty of a living God, not a dead God. Because he knows, because earlier he said, this Goliath, he is a pagan Philistine. A pagan. A pagan is somebody who does not believe in our God. It's an unbeliever. He doesn't know what he's talking about. We do. So I'll go. And I love what Saul says. This is Saul, the king of Israel. This is the leader of Israel, and this is what he says. 33, don't be ridiculous, Saul replied. There's no way you can fight this Philistine and possibly win. You're only a boy, and he's been a man of war since his youth. Saul's perspective is that of fear and anxiety. Saul's perspective is that you can't. Saul's perspective is that God, I don't know if he's really real. I want you to look at chapter 16, verse 7. Somebody can read that. It's 1 Samuel 16, verse 7.
You have never, ever heard
Never heard of it. I come to you and I sat here and said, hey guys, here's a thing called a chair. See how beautiful this chair is? And this chair has four legs. See the four legs? And this chair is strong enough to hold your weight. Yeah. Oh yeah, that's a chair. That is an academic understanding of the chair. I can tell you everything that I need to tell you about that chair. I can describe this chair. I can tell you the dimensions of this chair. I can tell you the sturdiness of this chair because somebody else once told me about this chair. And that's what Saul has. Saul has an understanding, an academic understanding of what this chair is. David is different. David has an experiential faith. How is his different? David, not only can he tell you all about this chair, not only can he describe the dimensions, not only can he tell you how comfortable this chair is, but the difference between David and Saul is that David sat in the chair. David knows, has experienced the chair for himself. David has not learned about the chair from other people. Although he has, but David at some point said, I have to take my academic understanding of what this chair is all about, and I have to sit in it for myself. Because you can sit here and come to church Sunday after Sunday and Sunday, and you can repeat things in that Bible, you can repeat stories, you can talk about the characters of this Bible, you can talk about Jesus, and you can only describe the chair. But until you take the things in that Bible, until you take those things in the words of that scripture, and you live it out for yourself, and you sit in this chair, you will never know how good, how trustworthy, how precious, how loving your Jesus is. You will never truly understand that cross. Never. You will be able to talk about the cross all day long. You will be able to regurgitate things that you have heard from me, from other speakers, all day long. And you will fake it to everybody else. And everyone will think you are a Christian. You will be so fooled to even think that you are a Christian when you're not. Are you a believer? Or is this just something you've read? A true believer in Jesus Christ has experienced him. They sat in that experience and they know that they know that they know my Jesus is real. He has shown up multiple times in my life. There have been times in my own life when I was at the deepest and I was down and out when he showed up and he rescued me. He gave me hope again. There were times in my life when I was depressed where I thought about committing suicide. In my 20s. I remember in New York, when I left Dallas and I went to New York, I had gone out and I had done things that I regret. And I came home and I was laying on the floor of my apartment and I could no longer hear his voice. Because I gave my life over to him at 19. At 19, I gave my life to him. And in my 20s, I had walked away from him. And on that floor in my apartment in New York City, I lay there. And I was thinking to myself, I cannot hear his voice anymore. And it was in that moment I got on my knees. And I prayed. And I asked him to forgive me for what I had done. And I asked him to let me hear your voice again. And it was that day going forward that he rescued me again. My God, he is alive. a lot of Christians, a lot of believers celebrate Easter, but their life thinks and shows that Jesus is still buried in that tomb. So they walk around life and like, okay, well, I gotta go to school. I gotta get the grades. I gotta graduate. I gotta go to college. I gotta do this. Distracted by the things of this world, through friendships, through social groups. They get connected into things that they just should not. And they can't hear the Spirit. They can't hear what God is trying to tell them because they've drifted so far away. And they start to think that Jesus, yeah, he's a great guy. He's a great teacher. Maybe even a great philosopher. He's a great humanitarian. Man, the humanitarian stuff that he did, crazy. But that's another book. It's just a book. I said this earlier with the adults. I have seen so many people in what I've gone to from churches in the U.S., but when I go to their houses, I see a lot of youth that have two or three Bibles. Two or three Bibles in their room, collecting dust. But their physics book, chemistry book, their Sports Illustrated book, their Cosmopolitan magazine, they open that stuff up. And they're eating that stuff up. But their Bible just sits there on the side, collecting dust. At some point, you gotta take this academic understanding of who your God is, and you have to finally start to experience who He is for yourself. Otherwise, what are you doing? This is not a true faith then. You're coming to church as is your client number one or client number two. You just do what you do. This is just your routine. This is a tradition. Sunday, you come, you fill these pews up. And then for those who are 13 and above, you'll go walking down that aisle all the way up to the sanctuary. You will kneel and you will ask for forgiveness for what you did that past week. Only to step back down from that aisle, go back out that door, and start to do the same old thing. And then come back on Sunday, go right back up there, and partake in the body and blood, and never really understanding what He did for you and what He did for me. So we ridicule what the gospel is all about. Because we don't really understand. It's an academic understanding. So then we see this, verse 40. He picked up five smooth stones from a stream and put them in his shepherd's bag. Then he armed only with a shepherd's staff and sling. He started across the valley to fight the Philistine. Do you see that? He started across the valley to fight the Philistine. I wonder if this is possibly true. I don't know if this is true or not. But I wonder in this moment, David stepped bending down, picking up those five stones, putting it into his shepherd's bag, picking up a staff, and as he's walking down that valley, knowing where he's about to go, that he's about to go fight this huge 9-foot, 9-inch tall giant, the one that everybody behind him is afraid of. I wonder if this is that moment where he started to think about writing Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. Though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For thy rod and thy axe, thy rod strengthens me. I wonder if this is where Psalms 23 got its start. Because when David wrote Psalms 23, he knew he was a shepherd, and he knows who his shepherd is, and that he walks through the valley of death when he goes to face Goliath. He knows he has nothing to be afraid of. I wonder if this is where he started to think of these Psalms. So then we see in 4:41, Goliath walked out towards David with his shield bearer ahead of him, sneering in contempt at this ruddy-faced boy. "Am I a dog?" he roared, "that you come to me with a stick?" He cursed David with the names of his God. "Come over here, and I'll give you your flesh to the birds and the wild animals," Goliath yelled. And David replied to the Philistine this, "You come to me with the sword, spear, and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of heaven and of heaven's armies, the God of armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Today, the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut your head off. And then I will give it to the dead bodies of the men, to the men and to the birds and the wild animals. And the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And everyone assembled here will know that the Lord rescues his people, but not with the sword and spear. This is the Lord's battle, and he will give you to us." Like, how awesome is David? Right? Shepherd boy, scrawny little kid. He's probably like 13 years old. Like some of you. Some of you, it's just like him. And he sits there and goes, "Oh yeah? Well, here's the truth, buddy. Here's what the reality is. You're going to be the one who's going to get defeated. I'm going to come after you. I'm going to be the one who's going to cut your head off. And then I'm going to take your body and give it to the birds. Because you think you're going to do that to me? You don't know me, and you don't know him." Amen? Amen. Do you not see this? Like, this is amazing to me. That David would know this and be courageous at 13. This is not him at 44. This is not him at 30-something. This is him at like 12 or 13 years old. To be that bold, to be that courageous, to know who he is, to know who his God is. And then he does this because he knows he can't defeat him. So he does a football move. The football move is this. Guys who appreciate this analogy, girls, just go along with me. Okay? So the football move is this. You've got the quarterback who handles the ball all the time. This is David. David knows that this is not a physical battle. David knows this is a spiritual battle. That his God is going to go before him. And he is going to conquer for him. So David takes the football and he passes it off to who? God, who is the running back. He passes the ball and he gives it to the running back, and the running back is behind taking the football, and he knows where he's going. You can't stop God. You can't. David knows this is not a physical battle. He realizes that this is a spiritual battle, which is why he tells Goliath, "My God, the Lord of the Israel armies, will defeat you." And then when he's done with you, when he's got all that to that point, I'm going to come and finish you up. Does that make sense? So then we see this. 48. As Goliath moved closer to attack, David quickly ran out to meet him. Reaching into his shepherd's bag and taking out a stone, he hurled it with his sling and hit the Philistine in the forehead. The stone sank into Goliath's head, stumbled and fell and face down to the ground. Here's what happens. Goliath moves closer. What does David do? Did you see what he does? Do you see what he does? It says, Goliath walked closer. What does David do? Look at scripture. This is really important. He goes what? He runs. He runs after Goliath. Goliath is walking with confidence. And I believe Goliath started to kind of shake in his confidence. Because the words that David was speaking was the truth of who God is. And when you speak truth out loud to your enemy, to your fears, to your anxiety, your fears and your anxiety start to shake and they start to get nervous. because they're hearing something that is true. In the scriptures, it says, even the demons know who Jesus is. The demons know who he is, and the demons are afraid of him. So if you start to speak the truth, if you start to speak scripture, you're speaking the power of God's name out loud. And when you speak that kind of name, that kind of power, that kind of authority, your fears and anxieties will start to quench. Now here's the other thing. David goes reaching for what? A stone. How many stones did he pick up? I'm saying 5. Have you ever wondered why David picked up 5 stones when he only used 1? I thought that. For the longest time, I always wondered that. So in seminary, when I was going through some of these classes, we were studying this passage, and it was so cool to see. David picks 5 stones. 5 stones from that stream. Puts it into his shepherd's bag. He only uses 1 to take out Goliath. So he still has 4 left. Why? 2 Samuel chapter 21, verse 20 to 22. Somebody could read that. 2 Samuel chapter 21, 20 to 22. There's not just this one David of Goliath in your life. Now here's the thing. I want you to be very, very clear about this. David in this story is not you. A lot of people, when they teach this, make David out to be you, out to be me. That's not true. You know who you are? You know who I am in this story? The Israel army. We're the army that's sitting there shaking. Because we can't. We cannot defeat Goliath. We can't. But there is one David who would come down the road, and his name is Jesus. And that Jesus kills Goliath finally and forever. He has done what we cannot. So when you read this passage, when you hear this story, do not walk away thinking, oh, I'm David. I just got to go reach into my pebbles and throw this pebble at Goliath. No, that's not you. That's not you. David is Jesus. David is Jesus in this story. You and I, we're the camp. We're the army, just getting scared. But David comes and rescues me. Just like Jesus comes and rescues you and rescues me. Because Jesus can where I can't. I'm going to end with this story about my incident that gave me a whole lot of faith in who my Jesus is. So this is probably 90s, right? I'll be honest. This is the 90s. I'm in college. Okay? I'm in college in the 90s. I take my car to a car wash, and there's these different bays that you can go clean your car. You probably have seen it here, maybe not. But you've got these different bays, and each person can go to their bay, and you can wash, you can soap, you can dry, you can clean, you can vacuum in each bay your car. Okay? So here I am, it was on a Saturday morning, I went up there and was in the bay. When I drove up, all of the bays were empty. It was just me. So I drove up into the bay, I started to clean my car and, you know, put some coins in and wash the car. This truck, this is in Dallas, Texas. Probably the bad thing about Texas. In Dallas, this big old truck comes pulling up. The other bays are empty. Keep in mind, this truck pulls up in front of my bay. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, okay, I don't understand what this guy's doing. There's other bays that are empty, so why? Whatever. So then I just go back to cleaning my car. These two guys pull out, get out of that truck, and they come walking towards me. And this is, you know, the stereotypical good old boys, you know, that came out of that truck and they're wearing their trucker hats, and they came out and they go, "Hey boy, what are you doing?" And I was like, "I'm washing my car, man." And they were like, "You washing your car? Were you from like Iraq or something? You one of them ratheads?" And I was like, "Okay, this is not gonna go good." They don't want to learn about Jesus in this moment. So this is not gonna go good, right? So they start to walk closer and closer to me, and I can tell from their body posture that there's gonna be a fight. One guy against these two guys, right? So in my mind, I'm like, "Oh dang, get ready, show them what you got, Sam, show them what you're working with." So I'm like getting in the stance, because I know what's about to happen, right? These two guys start to walk closer and closer and closer, and all of a sudden, they stop. And I'm sitting there going, "Yeah, it's my stance, ain't it? You scared of my stance. I know you don't want any of this. Back up, boys." And you know, I'm getting cocky in my own self, right? And I looked at their eyes, and they were looking at me. They looked right past me. Directly past me. And I'm sitting there going, "Wait, what are y'all looking at?" Right? I'm thinking this in my head, in my ninja stance, right? And I'm thinking to myself, "What are they looking at?" Because they stopped dead in their tracks. And they looked right past me. So I'm like, "Okay." And I look back, and there are these two big black guys. Huge black guys. Standing right behind me. And they come walking up to me. And they say, "Are these two boys bothering you, son?" And I was just like, "Yeah, they are. What you got now?" Right? And these two guys are towering, standing next to me. And I'm like, "Yeah, I don't know. Are we having a problem, you boys?" Right? And the guys are just like, "No, it's cool. We're good." And the black guys are like, "Seems like you got a problem. He's our friend. We've known him forever. If you got a problem with him, you got a problem with us." And they're like, No, we're just gonna go. We're cool." So they get in their truck and they drive away. And here I am looking at them just driving away, going, "Yeah. What's up?" And I look at the two guys like, "Hey guys," and they're gone. Car wash spot. Never saw it. these two guys, and I saw these two big black guys. And I remember to this day, one of them said, "We know him." We know who he is. He's our friend. And if you've got a problem with him, you got a problem with us. I believe God sent the two angels. That is just one example how I know that I know that I know my God is alive and living. He is real. He is not buried in that tomb. He has risen, and he goes before me, preparing a way. And because of that, because of what he has done for me, I will go to the ends of the earth for him. I will not be ashamed. I will not be timid. You have to experience God for yourself. You cannot sit there and believe in a God that Sam believes. You have to believe in that God for yourself. Because that God will face all of your giants, and that God will defeat your fears, your worries, and your anxieties. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father God, for this opportunity for all of us just to be able to be here. I thank you for these, your children that are seated here in these pews. God, I don't know what they're going to do. I have no idea what they're facing. I have no idea what the struggles that they're encountering. But you do, because you are God and I am God. But just like me, you showed up. And you showed me that you were real. I pray, Father, that you would make yourselves known so much to these individuals, these kids, that they would know that they know that they know who you truly are, and that their belief in you would grow as each day and week and month and year goes by. And that they would not be timid, that they would not be afraid of what they are going to encounter, the things that they might hear, but that they would stand boldly for you. That they would truly start to change from client number one and a two to be a client number three. Help them to live a life that would make you proud. Help them to live a life that would be a sweet aroma to you. So we ask all these things in your Son's name.